one of those like five, four. No, the red light is on. Okay, we're starting. Okay, today's topic, fascinating topic, Sarah Schenirer. She is the founder of the most revolutionary movement in women's education in the Jewish world for all time. A rather amazing achievement. We're going to look at her life and her thought and spend a little bit of time talking about her impact on, really leveraging some tremendous change in Eastern Europe and ultimately in America and beyond. I'll tell you a little bit about the quick bio. Oops, this moved to the wrong slide. The very quick biographical statistics. This is the only known photograph we have of her. She didn't like having her photograph taken. She didn't like having her photograph posted in any of her classrooms or anything like that. She was born in Krakow in 1883, and she died prematurely at age 52 in 1935. Her background is from the Belzer Hasidic dynasty, and her father was a fairly well-to-do merchant. The family had some wherewithal. They could move here and there, and it made a big difference for her, as we shall see shortly. Her major claim to fame, I don't know why it's blocking out the little bottom part of the screen there somehow. I don't think it's there. I think it's the other machine. It's searching for the VGA. Maybe one day it'll find it. But at any rate, I know what I'm talking about. She founded this Bais Yaakov movement in 1917 that grew to astronomical proportions, as I shall show you in the next slide. And I think what's especially fascinating about her that's not well recognized is that she was really a master CEO, chief executive officer. She was able, with an eighth grade education, to parlay an idea into a phenomenal revolutionary movement that involved thousands upon thousands of people and has now lasted and is going strong for about seven generations now. And the products of her educational school were especially well-renowned for their behavior during the Holocaust in particular. When the name Bais Yaakov was synonymous with chesed, with kindness, with self-sacrifice, and with a tremendous attention to the values of the Jewish people. I'm going to show you the slide that says it all. If you want to leave and go home, you just look at this slide and then you've seen everything. Now, unfortunately, there's something funny about the projector. You're missing what's happening here. But this is the growth of her school system only in Poland, where it was started. There were many other branches also in Czechoslovakia and elsewhere. She started in 1918. When she started taking statistics in 1923 over here, she had seven students. That's under the block here. With 1,000 students. That means within 5 years, 1,000 students. And then incredible growth. Over 10 years, she eventually got 26 schools, 26 institutions. I'm sorry, is that cut off? Yes, this is wrong. It's 265 institutions. Excuse me while I just quick correct this. It appears that the formatting went kind of funny on me. Well, I think it's because I used the iCloud. I'm sorry. It's 265 institutions with a total of 37,981 students within 10 years. Truly astronomical. I mean, this growth is faster than, let's say, McDonald's in terms of its franchise ability. And the impact on the Jewish world is similarly huge. It's also interesting to note, and McDonald's is not such a far-off kind of comparison, because what amazes me is that not only she was able to engineer such phenomenal growth, but she was able to keep it all on mission, meaning that all of these institutions could grow up so quickly and could produce a uniform product, as it were, a graduate, that embodied the same kind of values that she really started with at the beginning. Truly an amazing achievement for any CEO to be able to handle such phenomenal growth within such a short period of time and to produce the same kind of product, i.e. graduates, over and over again. So this is really what we're talking about tonight, the life and works of Sarah Schenirer, and specifically what she did with the Bais Yaakov institutions in Poland. Okay, any questions before we dive in straight away? Okay, let's go straight to it then. Okay, so she was born, as I mentioned, in 1883 in Poland, and she only made it through eighth grade in school. That was graduating level for Polish girls in Krakow in the 1890s. Let's bear in mind that by today's standards, the educational attainments were quite modest for the average person. To give you an example, in nearby Russia, which had slightly less significant, well, actually, Poland at this time was part of Russia, and this is Congress Poland, but their educational attainments were slightly lower in Poland for Jews as well. In 1897, they had a massive census, and they discovered that the Jews were the most literate ethnic group, more literate than Russians and Poles and so on, but that literacy rate was only 60% for men. Amazingly, 6 out of 10 men could read, and that was the highest level of literacy in the entire empire. So our standards today are obviously much higher. We hope for something, at least among Jews, for close to 100% literacy rate. But, you know, bearing that in mind, an 8th grade education represented really something significant of the time for women. It is a fallacy that there was no education for women in pre-communist Russia. There were chadarim, primary school level, you know, private schools that are organized on a casual basis in local shtetla, and they were typically co-ed till about 4th grade at the oldest. Typically girls would be out of these chadarim by the time they finished 2nd or 3rd grade, and the ultimate goal was for a girl to learn how to read from the siddur. That was considered an adequate attainment for a moderately Orthodox Jewish girl. She should learn how to daven from the siddur, and then otherwise she would, you know, learn everything else she needed at home. Hang on 1 second, Ms. Abrams, I'll just finish. For a boy, 4th grade was considered really quite an achievement, and then they would almost invariably be tracked to some kind of vocation, to work in business, to work as an apprentice, as a shoemaker, a tinsmith, things like that. So the vast majority of Jews, male and female, received very little advanced education, but obviously females were highly disadvantaged. The fact that she went to 8th grade says a lot about her socioeconomic status and especially about her personal initiative and interest in learning. Mrs. Abrams.
Except for Lithuania, Tells had a school called Yavna. Mm-hmm. And in Yavna, the women learned, there was a school, you know, for girls.
Give me the year. What years are you referring to?
Yeah, 8th. Same time.
Interesting. I'll look it up. I don't think Yavna is more than 1920s.
1920s? But yeah. I think how old, I don't know, I'd have to go back and see how old it tells. Again, this year was what, 19?
We're looking at the early 1890s.
The early 1890s. I'll look it up. Okay. Because I think that from the start, they always had. Now, in Germany, of course, they did have
yes.
Schenirer.
But don't jump ahead of my lecture yet.
Okay,
that's right. Okay, so 8th grade. What was her religious... Okay, one more question, please.
I'm a little bit confused. You said that 60% of the men were literate.
Yes.
Are you referring to Jewish men?
Jewish men.
Okay.
36% of Jewish men were literate in any language.
Uh-huh.
That includes Hebrew and Yiddish.
Yes.
What was her religious education? At the time, there were no established schools at this level for women. She was, of course, the pioneer who created them. But she went to a secular Polish school. She went to a state school. And as per the Congress Polish regulations, there was 1 to 2 hours a week of religious instruction that was mandatory as part of the curriculum. Since there were so many Jewish girls in the school district of Krakow, they would separate them, and they would have a priest come in and speak to the Polish girls, and a rabbi would come in and speak to the Jewish girls, maximum, though, 2 hours a week. That was the extent of her formal Jewish education. Everything else she got from home. She was nevertheless a deeply pious young woman, and her friends called her the little chassid. It was not meant as a compliment. It was meant as a little bit of a ribbing, a little bit of a joke, because she was simply so pious that the rest of them couldn't quite stand her when she got so, you know, punctilious about the observance of the commandments. She combined this, however, with an intense love of nature. She was famous for, you know, going for long walks in the woods, like many of the spiritual characters we've seen throughout this class, the Baal Shem Tov, Shabtai Tzvi. I hate to put them all in the same group here, but, you know, walks in the woods are considered something that's very popular among this people of spiritual attainments. She used to love going into the mountains, and she was environmentally very advanced for her time. Very interested in connecting with nature, of observing, you know, the wonders of God through the natural world around her. Once she finished eighth grade, she went into the field as a seamstress, which was an adequate vocation for her, or for a young woman of her generation, and she spent several years simply working as a seamstress. Now, we have to place this within a context, an educational crisis that was happening at the time. There were many competing movements that were hoping to attract Jewish young minds and souls at the time, specifically Zionism and socialism, which we spoke a little bit when we talked about Herzl, and then when we talked about Trotsky, we looked at these kind of vectors that Jews were following in large numbers.
And
mixtures of them, yeah. Poalei Tzion, of course, you have like varieties of two Jews, three opinions. At the same time, there was accessibility of higher education for some women as well. Exceptionally wealthy Jewish women would have the option of going to universities. And so you have women enrolling in several universities. There was a numerus clausus, meaning a quota that limited the number of Jews who were allowed to attend universities. Congress Poland, however, prided itself on being fairly egalitarian, of allowing women to take classes in certain subjects. And even more significantly, you have the profusion of an institution called the Volksuniversität, the People's University, which is kind of like a free university. They did not grant diplomas, and they were supported primarily by donations, but nevertheless, they attracted a lot of people who simply wanted to learn something. It's broadly similar, I think, to the way Stanford puts a lot of their lectures online, and Harvard is putting their lectures online, and even we're putting our lectures online, where it's just free for the rest of the world, because it's a nice thing to do. So that was a popular thing, and she attended many lectures of this nature. However, there were still huge gender disparities despite these kinds of availabilities to women. I'm going to explore those in a little bit, in just a moment. There were also very significant economic pressures placed on Jews at this time. Now we're getting into the beginning of the 20th century. I'm taking a figure a little bit later, but from Yaakov Leschinsky, who is arguably one of the greatest Jewish demographers of all time, he did an intense study of Jews in Poland in 1929, and he found that fully 50% of Jews who were members of synagogues paid no dues, and 30 to 35% paid only a token amount. So that means something like 80 to 85% of the members of a given synagogue in Poland did not pay any dues or paid very little dues. And about 15% of the congregations were supporting the rest of the membership, which gives you a sense of the huge amount of need that was within the Jewish community. How that relates to women is that women were slowly being pressured by their own families and by the needs within their four walls to enter the workforce and to bring home some income, because the need was intense. And even though Jewish women have always been involved in various forms of gainful employment, they typically tended to be home-based, helping out in the business, some kind of cottage industry like piecework. But to actually go out and get a job, that would be something that was still quite unusual for the turn of the 20th century. But these are the pressures that women are facing at the time.
It was 3 years, 1922 to 1932.
Yes, absolutely. But earlier as well, we see this phenomenon happening. This is a graph that didn't work. I tried to create it, and it just doesn't make sense. I was trying to illustrate something that economists call a scissors crisis. So instead of showing you with these nice colors that my Mac could do, I'll just show you in a charade. As anyone familiar with this economic term, a scissors crisis? So a scissors crisis occurs when, let's say, prices go up, right, but income goes down, right? So you've got...
That's what we're in right now.
Yeah, well, that's right. A lot of people are like that, and our country can be like that, too. Let's say with tax base, for example, you know, our expenses have gone up, medical insurance, for example, and our tax base has gone down with the subprime mortgage crisis, and so how are you going to pay for that gap? You have a scissors crisis because of the difference between the two vectors that the economy is going on. So in terms of the Jewish world at this time, educationally, we have a serious scissors crisis. Men are getting a stronger Jewish education through the beginning of the 20th century, partially because of the poor economy. Some men are forced to stay in school longer, to hang around shul, because they don't have a job. Not that that's a bad reason to stay around shul, you know, you can stay just because it's fun to hang around shul. And women are getting a low Jewish education. So you got a scissors crisis there. And then when you duplicate that, women who have means are able to get a high secular education, whereas men tend to get a very low secular education. So you can have one family where you'll have young men who are like really religiously motivated and very knowledgeable about Torah and Talmud and so on, and their women know nothing about it. Their sisters, I should say, know nothing about it, but what they do know about is French literature and Adam Mickiewicz and Polish literature and things like that. Who are they going to marry? There's almost like two populations growing along gender lines. And this is something that Sarah Schenirer was very conscious of. I'd like to read to you something from her Gesamte Schriften, her collected writings. This is something how she describes the feeling of girls in the Hasidic world around this time. And as we pass, well, this is an excellent book, by the way, Shoshana Pantel Zoltis, and All Your Children Shall Be Learned, Women and the Study of Torah and Jewish Law and History. I've actually read this more than once. It's a very good book. And as we pass through the Elul days, the trains which run to the little shtetlach where the rebbes live are crowded. Thousands of Hasidim are on their way to spend the Yamim Noraim with the Rebbe. Every day sees new crowds of old men and young men in Hasidic garb, eager to secure a place on the train, eager to spend the holiest days in the year in the atmosphere of the Rebbe, to be able to extract from it as much holiness as possible. Fathers and sons travel. Thus they are drawn to Ger, to Belz, to Alexander, to Bobov, to all those places that had been made citadels of the concerted religious life, dominated by the figure of the Rebbe's personality. And we, women, we stay at home, the wives, the daughters, and the little ones. We have an empty Yom Tov. It is bare of Jewish intellectual content. The women have never learned anything about the spiritual content that is concentrated within a Jewish festival. The mother goes off to synagogue, but the services echo faintly into the fenced and boarded off women's galleries. There is much crying by the elderly women. The young girls look at them as though they belong to a different century. Youth and the desire to live a full life shoot up violently in the strong-willed young personalities. Outside the synagogue, the young girls stand chattering. They walk away from synagogue where their mothers pour out their vague and heavy feelings. They leave behind them the wailing of the older generation and follow the urge for freedom and self-expression. Further and further away from synagogue they go, further away to the dancing, tempting light of a fleeting joy. And she's describing here the gendered nature of the Jewish world at the turn of the 20th century, where men, especially Hasidic men who will leave their families for the Yomim Noraim, or the Yomim Tovim, leave their women behind. And the women, because they don't have an education to be able to generate interest and enthusiasm in what they're doing, are kind of like left at loose ends. And is it surprising that the youth will be disaffected and will be attracted to movements like Zionism, socialism, and so on? This is the world into which Sarah Schenirer stepped with her ideas of Jewish education. Ms. Abrams.
I have a question. You know, today we were learning about, you know, the formation of Agudat Yisrael. Mm-hmm. And the girls, you know, we had a film today, and the girls said, well, these people look like they have money. There must have been some people. So there was a lot of poverty, especially in Russia. But let's say, for example, in Poland, that was not part of Russia, or, you know, the place where they started Agudat Yisrael, what did they do? Because some people lived, I said that many people lived in the cities, mm-hmm. and so they were entrepreneurs, and they did, you know, but do you have any, was there any other information on that?
There's a lot of information on it. I would refer you to Yaakov Leschinsky's work on the economic makeup of the Jewish world. About 60% of Jews were involved in one form of commerce or another. And so when you have 60% of Jews in business, at least a few of them are going to be successful. And also the films, I haven't seen the films they're seeing, but chances are, you know, if you are a Rebbe and you're going on film representing your Kehillah, chances are you'll wear your best suit. Oh, okay, so I'm not sure, I haven't seen it. Let's go to Vienna now. So what happens? The turning point in Sarah Schenirer's life is in 1914. When her fairly well-to-do family decides that they want to avoid the front lines that, in case they were to approach Krakow, and they move to the larger city of Vienna in Austria. And it is there that she began her, you know, she went, as she usually did, to classes of one type or another, and she met a rabbi, Moshe Flesch, who was a third-generation student of Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch. Pictured here, you recall, we had a lecture on Rav Hirsch and his thought. And she was simply overwhelmed with Rav Hirsch's thought, which at that time had not really penetrated Eastern Europe. Eastern Europe was still far too traditional to accept the kind of melding of secular ideas with Judaism that Rav Hirsch was able to somehow accomplish. And she was especially taken with this idea of der Judmensch, of the Jewish human being, in which Rav Hirsch argued that a Jew should not be simply cloistered within the four cubits of halacha without, you know, looking at the outside world. We are, after all, human animals. We do exist in a multicultural society. And Rav Hirsch argued that to be a well-rounded human being, one has to learn how to adapt and understand outside society. This is in many ways the foundation stone of the educational philosophy of Yeshiva University, with its motto of Torah Umada, right? Torah studies and secular studies. Right? And so she thought this was absolutely fantastic. It was overwhelming for her. And for 4 years, she imbibed the philosophy of Rav Hirsch through his student, Rabbi Dr. Flesch's lectures. And then she brought them back to Poland, where she met lots of opposition. When she went back to Krakow and she thought, you know, why don't we get together? And she started to work with slightly older girls, high school girls. She thought, let's bring together some young women and let's study these ideas. Let's study geography and history and literature and things like that. And within a Jewish context, always understanding it through the prism of Torah. And she met opposition from both left and right. The opposition on the left wing of the Jewish community was primarily from people who were involved with the Haskalah, the Jewish Enlightenment. And there were some educational opportunities for women in the Haskalah, the Tarbut schools, for example, which were much more left-leaning and much more Zionistic. Some actually had a socialistic bend at the same time. And they felt that, you know, her idea was quixotic and doomed to failure. How can you possibly, they argued, combine ultra-traditional attitudes to, you know, women being in the home and women being tzniut, with traditional modesty, with modern pedagogy and enlightened ideas? So they poo-pooed the idea entirely. And on the right, in the community that you'd think she would get the most response, there was a lot of suspicion about the idea of taking teenage girls out of the home and having who knows who educate them in some strange idea. It was totally unheard of that women should have some kind of formal education. And so the right wing was really quite suspicious of this whole idea from this woman that they called the little Hasidic one. Ultimately, however, she was able to achieve some early endorsement from some very significant figures, and that really started the ball rolling for her. She first went to the Belzer Rebbe. She was a Belzer Chassid, if you'll recall. And she wouldn't go directly to the Belzer Rebbe herself. She sent her brother. Her brother went to the Rebbe, described the nature of the project while the Rebbe was at Marienbad enjoying the spa. This is something that you don't see rabbis doing too much nowadays. But back then, you know, every few months it appears that they would go to these hot springs and they would, like, I don't know, rabbis in hot tubs, it seems so strange. But they would do it regularly, and that's one of the few places where they could be photographed, for example. Many of them didn't like having photos in those studios, but at the spa, it was okay. It was kind of like vacation. All the rules were different. I guess what happens in Marienbad stays in Marienbad, something like that, right?
Ostiani.
And then, something like that. Anyways, the brother of Sarah Schenirer went up to the Rebbe and he asked him what he thought of this idea. And the Rebbe had two-word response for him: bracha v'hatzlacha, blessing and success, which within the Hasidic world is an assent of approval. I don't know too much about it, but I understand that in the diamond district, when you're buying and selling diamonds, they don't use documents. Nobody, you say mazel and bracha? Okay. So not bracha and hatzlacha. I wonder what the difference is, bracha and hatzlacha, mazel and bracha. But apparently it was like a ringing endorsement that allowed Sarah Schneider to say, hey, but the Belzer Rebbe said bracha and hatzlacha to anyone who opposed her. So she began to get a little traction for her idea with that particular statement. Then the Agudas Yisrael, which had just been formed a few years earlier, also initially approved the idea. They would later become absolutely enthralled with the idea, as I shall describe shortly. And one by one, many other significant rebbes indicated their approval. The Gera Rebbe, the sixth Lubavitcher Rebbe, the Friedrich Rebbe, as they call him, the Chafetz Chaim wrote a teshuvah in 1918 that specifically endorsed this movement. And they all followed along saying this is a great idea. By the way, this is a picture. This is the only known true photograph of the Chafetz Chaim. Here he is right over here. You just get a three-quarter view of his face. The picture that it popularly circulates, you know, the glowing skin and like the luminous beard and things like that, many authorities dispute that it's actually the Chafetz Chaim himself. I've heard one expert say that it's actually the butcher of Radin, you know, and he had a very Schenirer punim, so that's what he looked like. You know, for a long time, I didn't know Yiddish when I was a kid. I don't really know Yiddish that much now, but for a long time, I thought that my middle name was Shana Ponen, my grandmother, you know? Anyways, so she starts the idea. She begins with 25 students. Later, she would make a pun on that number 25, which happens to be the gematria, the numerical equivalent of the word ko, chafhe, and she related it to the verse, ko somar le Bais Yaakov, the hagid le Bais Yaakov. Tagid le b'nei Yisrael. It's terrible. I sound like an ignoramus. I'm going to put this on the internet too. It's actually my evil twin brother speaking. But how does it go? Thus shall you say to the house of Jacob, and so shall ye instruct the children of Israel. Rashi says there, famous Rashi, what's the difference between the Bais Yaakov and the b'nei Yisrael? B'nei Yisrael is in the masculine. That refers to the men. You have to tell the men. But before that, you speak to the house of Jacob, that refers to the women. Hence the name for the school system, Bais Yaakov, the house of Jacob, because that's the reference to the Rashi, the Midrash on that particular passage. So as I mentioned earlier, the Agudas Yisrael, this fairly right-wing, religious, quasi-political party that we spoke about when we talked about the various intellectual and political options of Jews. This was a highly traditionalist modality for Jews who didn't want to be Zionist, didn't want to be socialist, didn't want to immigrate, that they wanted to have some kind of body that could articulate their political views on the national scene. And they actually were a legitimate political party in Poland. They actually ran in elections and they had seats in the Polish parliament and so on. It was very much a formal organization. When they met for their first Knesia Gedola, for their first great assembly in 1923, they were so impressed with what Sarah Schenirer was doing that they elected to take over her movement and say, this is the educational arm of Agudas Yisrael for the women of Poland. It was a phenomenal statement. It came with a big price tag because they were willing to give it a lot of financial support to enable it to exist. But it also created more of a ripple effect of the success of Bais Yaakov, because now it was not, you know, just some woman from Krakow with a few rabbinic signatures running around trying to operate a school. Now it had the official imprimatur of none other than the Agudas Yisrael, very significant political organization of the day. I'm going to pause for questions, arguments.
No
arguments. Discrepancies. No arguments. Oh my God.
I once heard a story that people were against her. They went to the Chafetz Chaim and they had like a Din Torah sort of a thing. It wasn't really a formal Din Torah, but they went to make a complaint and they told him the whole story. I guess he hadn't heard about it yet. And he reached in his pocket and took out two kopecks and he gave it to him. And he said, here's my answer. He says, you make sure when you go back, you give this money to Sarah Schenirer. I want to make sure I have a chalik in this movement.
That's a good story. Yeah, I never heard that story. That's a good one. Yes.
So her plan was to educate women not only in Jewish topics but also in secular.
Yes, I'll show you the curriculum shortly. Yeah, it was a well-rounded school in many ways. Okay, so she was not starting up just another cheder, though. She was not starting up just an imitation men's school for women. It really was a brand new initiative based very heavily on the ideas of Rav Hirsch. The first thing she did was she hired two German-trained educators, Dr. Daniel Schmuel Deutschlander, who wrote most of the curriculum, and a woman named Fraulein Dr. Judith Rosenbaum, later married name of Grünfeld, and she's written a book on her experiences as well. So between the two of them, Dr. Deutschlander and the Fraulein Doctor, they really were able to engineer a curriculum and a pedagogy that could be packaged and reproduced with great success. By 1922, they had received accreditation from the Polish government, giving them legitimate status as a secondary school in the Polish school system. Graduates could then take their diplomas, could go on to tertiary institutions, and so on. When it came to the question of, well, what about all this secular material that's included in the curriculum? Is that kosher? Her approach was quite literally, as she's quoted to her students, eat the fruit and discard the peel. Meaning take what's worthwhile in it and everything else simply discard. Don't discard the entire fruit. Eat the fruit on the inside and discard the peel. And also included in her pedagogy, whoa, something happened here. Unable to download updates. I don't want updates. That's okay. Where's my mouse? Don't do weird things to me, please. My computer is behaving strangely. Okay, here we are. She integrated a lot of environmental education into the curriculum. Lots of tiulim, lots of trips into the Carpathian Mountains, Shabbatonim out of doors, all kinds of activities that really connected the young women to the outside world. When I talked about this with my students today, you know, I said it's surprising because I sent one of my daughters to the Bais Yaakov system here, and they didn't have, you know, that strong an emphasis on outdoor education. But one of my other students, who was also a graduate of Bais Yaakov, said that apparently in Israel, the Bais Yaakov schools really do a lot of it. They are constantly traveling all over the place and overnight and camping and things like that. That's very much true to her philosophy. Here's the curriculum, just point form. Obviously, lots of Jewish studies. On the left-hand side, you've got Bible, Tanakh, you've got Biur Tefillah, davening, prayer, Jewish history, Hebrew language, halakha, and then, it's hidden under this block, I don't know why we have this, psychology. They actually taught what was modern psychology at the beginning of the 20th century. And then going on to more secular subjects, pedagogy, because this was fundamentally a teacher's college. This was designed to create more teachers, which was the reason for her expansion. Polish and German language studies, so they would be literate in four languages, Polish, Hebrew, Lashon HaKodesh. They would not generally speak it as a spoken language, but I'll discuss an exception to that in a minute. German, and of course, the Mama Lashon, Yiddish. They also had gymnastics and handicrafts. That was the scope of their curriculum, and it was really quite successful, attracted a lot of students. Part of the way in which she attracted students was that she built the she built into the model of the education its own perpetuation. In several of the schools, she only accepted students if they would agree to later become teachers. And then what she would do is she would take one of her finer graduates, she would schlep her out to some, you know, shtetl 20 verst away from where the first Bais Yaakov was, and she would gather a meeting of the local Jewish women, and she would have this young woman who was a recent graduate give them a lecture on some topic in Jewish thought or practice and law. And after they had listened to this young woman give an eloquent presentation, Sarah Schneer would get up and say, now wouldn't you want a young woman like this teaching your daughters? And they would all say yes. And she'd say, okay, she's available right now. And she would plant them before they were married in that town, often starting within the month, their new career as principal of a Bais Yaakov franchise. And it was a model that could just be repeated over and over again with these graduates, because the program was only a few years long. And that's what really helped it on a structural level grow with such rapidity. But again, the graduates really, they imbibed the philosophy of this movement, and they were true representatives of what she was trying to achieve. She was also quite adept at fundraising, particularly when they were building their first building. They created these little cards called Bausteins, or bricks, and it was like a picture of a building, and it was a brick, and you know, she would carry it around, and she would sell these Bausteins to whoever wanted to contribute to the construction of the building. There's one building they built in 1927. They actually, because they were so, they had such demands on the facility, they moved in before the upper floors were completed. And every day, even long after it was completed, the general contractor would come back and inspect all of the buildings, all of the things that he had created. And Sarah Schneer one day asked him, you know, why do you always come back and check out, you know, the drywall and the paint and things like that? Why are you coming back every day? And he says, because, Mrs. Schneer, I have built many buildings, but after I die, I will leave all of them behind except for this one. I want to make sure it's built exactly right. So it was an interesting kind
very
of...
Very nice.
Yeah, I think so too. She also was a publicist. She was quite a prolific essayist. She even wrote a couple of plays as well for her students. And plays have become, just as an aside, a really important part of the Bais Yaakov curriculum. They call them productions. I'm sure you've heard of production. And I always thought, when I was first introduced to that term, I always thought it was a funny kind of, they didn't call them school plays. When I went to secular high school, we had a school play, right? South Pacific or something like that. But they call, the Bais Yaakov calls them productions. And I think of them the way my grandmother, Aleha Shalom, would use that word. You know, such a production. It was like a big ungepatscht hoo-ha that had so many details. It was like mildly self-deprecating. But the theater was a very important part of her milieu, and she did it with her own writing. She created a journal called the Bais Yaakov Journal that not only was widely successful, she sold it as a 1 ruble a week tutor for girls who lived in rural environments. So if they had no access to a Bais Yaakov, then at least the parents could subscribe to the Bais Yaakov Journal, and she would have in Yiddish at least some source of contemporary material to read that was related to the overall philosophy of the school. She also created a supplementary youth group that was aligned with the Bais Yaakov movement called Benos. It still is in existence, Benos Agudas Yisrael, the Daughters of Agudas Yisrael. And this youth group had its a major convention also in 1927 with about 2,000 delegates, and it was the largest gathering of Jewish women in Polish history, period. 2,000 women coming together for one single convention. Right, okay. Yes, Mr. Lax.
What was the tuition?
The tuition, I don't know. That's a good question. It would be in this blue book here, but I forgot. I'm sure it was nominal. Tuition.
What does that bottom line say that you can't say?
That you can't say. It says, in 1919, it became the official educational arm of Agudas Yisrael. I'm glad you're paying attention. It makes me feel good that I write these. Now, let me ask you a more fundamental question, though. Who exactly was Sarah Schneer? It's fascinating when you read the literature. It comes in two flavors. One flavor is the extreme hagiographic material, meaning things that put her in with all the tzaddik literature that you have, published mainly by Orthodox presses that are especially interested in, you know, promoting her as an ideal model of Orthodox femininity. And in that model, you know, there's a lot of emphasis on how she spent a lot of attention on tzniut, on modesty, and on, you know, what you would think of, you associated with the traditional values of a Jewish woman in a Jewish home. But on the other hand, there's a lot of literature that's written more by the left wing of the Jewish community, and also non-observant Jews who are interested in looking at this amazing woman and what she achieved, who look at her as a kind of proto-feminist, who look at her as someone who empowered women, who created a revolutionary new movement that challenged the status quo and fundamentally altered the way in which women are trained in the modern world. And they point, for example, to the inclusion of secular studies in the curriculum, which was, you know, fairly controversial in a lot of Orthodox men's schools, and here she is building it right into the core of her school. If you look at, and let me give you one quotation of hers, which I think illustrates this very well. She used to tell her students that a Jewish girl has to have 2 pieces of paper, one in each pocket. This was an allusion to a passage in the Talmud that says everyone should carry around 2 pieces of paper. One paper should say check payable to, no, just kidding. one check, one pocket should say, you pick it out, and the document says, Bishvili Nivra Ha'olam, because of me, the world was created. And the other pocket should have a piece of paper that says, Ani Afar Va'efer, I am dust and ashes. So in other words, when you're feeling down, you pick out the paper that says, look, the whole world was created for me. When you're feeling, you know, too arrogant, you pick it up and say, remember, you're just dust and ashes. She said that a Jewish girl should have two other pieces of paper. One says, Kol Kvuda Bas Melech Pnima, all the glory of the princess is within, meaning internal, modest, private sphere, which is very traditional, tzniut kind of values. The other paper should say, Eis Lasos Lashem, it is time to act for God, which is invoked whenever people do something like out of the box and radical and sometimes challenging to the status quo. So on the one hand, she wanted girls to be, you know, retiring, modest, and, you know, within the traditional boundaries of Jewish behavior. But on the other hand, girls should be powerful, forceful, and unafraid to take a stand. So who's the, will a real Sarah Schenirer please stand up? A question? I'm sorry.
No, yes. I was going to say, isn't it represent an ideal synthesis between the women being educated and being able to combine empowerment with the sneers and everything else? Isn't that an ideal that we...
I would like to think that's true, but that's an ideal that she created. It's an ideal that she, well, maybe it's an ideal that she articulated for the modern world. We needed someone to be able to stand up and say, you know, it is not a diminishment of our daughters if they are literate. You know,
probably, and it, like today, the men were the biggest problem in their attitude.
The men, I think, usually are the biggest problem in their attitude. That's what my wife says all the time. Yes.
Did she ever marry?
She did, briefly, towards the end of her life. And that's a fascinating, you know, it's a fascinating question, really, that is amazingly ignored by almost all the scholarship. And I'm tempted to say that something that I should probably, I'm going to, Mr. Rodriguez, could you please put it on pause for a second? Okay, and
she
back
was very
to the engineer.
Busy all the time, so it was not the wife's side.
There, who knows? We're just speculating, but these are, I think, all reasonable things. Now, in her traditionalist modality, there's a lot of emphasis on tzniut in her teachings, over and over again, and down to great detail. Like, for example, the girls in Bais Yaakov were not allowed to cut their hair. They could not wear the popular bobs, for example, that were the style of the flappers of the time. One of my students today, the Bais Yaakov graduate, she said, oh, it's just like today. Whatever's fashionable, we can't do. And whatever's in fashion, that's not for us. So, and she insisted that the long hair had to be held up in a bun or a braid. And that's it. So, like, a lot of nitty-gritty detail to things like tzniut, which you'd think, okay, that must be very traditionalist. But on the other hand, she's also telling her students that they should not pray at home. They should go to the shul. She placed great emphasis on getting women to the public sphere for davening, which is not at all a traditional approach. She was also pro-Zionist, which was not, you know, lockstep with other movements, like even Agudas Yisroel, that was financially supporting her. She supported a series of movements called the Hakshara movements, where Benos students in particular, and Bais Yaakov students as well, prepared themselves for Aliyah. And she gave them all kinds of encouragement and wrote to them frequently, and she regarded movement to Israel, Aliyah to Israel, as a very high ideal, something which a lot of the Agudas Yisrael rabbis were opposed to at this time. So, you know, we had this discussion also with the girls today, with the young women in my class today, that there was a hesitancy to believe that Sarah Schenirer would ever, like, tell the Agudas Yisrael that she wanted to do this, that she would, like, you know, challenge them. And I can appreciate maybe she'd never challenge them, but on the other hand, if you have 37,000 students, you don't really need to challenge. I mean, just say, I believe this, and by the way, I have 37,000 students standing behind me who will do it the way I say. You know, unless she's going to say something really radical, she had a phenomenal amount of power simply because of the charisma that she utilized in creating this massive movement. So she was like probably the most powerful singular person in the educational world of Jews in the early 20th centuries. As I mentioned earlier, she got married late in life to Rabbi Yitzchak Landau, who was a member, he was a grandson of an important Hasidic Rebbe, but her health began to fade towards her late 40s and early 50s. The literature does not record specifically what illness she was fallen ill to, but she had a series of operations that left her in a weakened state. And in 1932, she elected to hand over the reins of Bais Yaakov to her longtime lieutenant, Rabbi Yehuda Leib Orlean, and he continued the movement towards the end of the pre-war period. Ultimately, she succumbed to her death at the early age of 52 in 1935, leaving her students bereft at her absence. But I'd like to end by specifically referring to something she wrote at the very end of her life. Shortly before passing, she wrote an open letter to her students, and she indicated to them that they should know that there were five psukim that she herself considered exceptionally important, and she wanted them to remember her by these five verses. I will read these verses and translate them to you now. Most of them are from Psalms. Ivdu es Hashem besimcha. Serve God in joy. You should do everything with simcha. Second, Shivisi Hashem lenegdi somid. I consider God before me at all times.
If I'm falling down.
And he is, you know, all my actions are must be, in the same sense, God's right in front of me. I have to be cognizant to my own activities because God is watching, so to speak. Reishis chachma yiras Hashem. The beginning of wisdom is the fear of God. First, the fear of God, then you can start being wise. But the fear of God is the beginning. Limnas yameinu kein hoda. Teach us to count our days. Meaning, teach us to value every moment, to live every day and understand it, its meaning. And finally, Torah Hashem Tamima Meshivas Nafesh. The Torah of Hashem is pure and it revives the soul. So with that, I'm going to conclude. I thank you very much for your attention and your interest in the life of this fantastic woman.
Thank you very much. In spite of the